TikTok, the app where 16-year-olds get millions of views for dancing, the love child of Snapchat and Vine, rest in peace, where lip syncs, dance-offs, push-up challenges, and jokes share space with existential dread and medical advice. And it all comes at you in an infinite, never-ending stream of 15 to 60-second bursts. Hi, I'm Raha Parfush. Welcome to United We Stand, the show that covers advanced internet culture. Today, we're talking about TikTok's design and specific features that are optimized for maximum virality. I want to show you why I think TikTok truly understands the nuances and dynamics of modern meme culture. Now, first, some context. TikTok lets users share 15 to 60 second clips of anything they want. There's this huge culture of remixing music, of lip syncing, of doing duets, and participating in collaborative challenges. But to really understand the heart of the community, you need to know about Musical.ly, an app that was acquired by TikTok's parent company, ByteDance, and that merged with TikTok to form the platform we all know and love today. So Musical.ly was designed originally to integrate music and video content easily with social networks, and it gave rise to a user base that would upload themselves singing, dancing, duetting each other. It was like all about karaoke and music. And the result was this engaged community that actively participated in creating content and where remixing and responding were encouraged behaviors. And it's these very features, originally designed for this Musical.ly community, that has given rise to an interactive, creator-focused content ecosystem. Now, for those of you wondering, why does so much of TikTok's content look the way that it does, right? With the lip syncs, the dancing, the music. Well, these are inherited cultural norms from Musical.ly's original base, and it's a big part of the current community's behavior. Now, serendipity also played a pretty big part in the app's growth, as the timing of the global pandemic created this unexpected demographic shift. Because before the pandemic, teens used to be the major user base, but thanks to quarantines, lockdowns, layoffs, all of a sudden, all of these things had an influx of millennials, Xers, and boomers who joined the platform, adding new types of content and creating all of these different subcultures. Now, today, TikTok's content verticals have expanded beyond music into expertise, advice, art, and so much more. And with a presence in 150 markets, over 30 languages, the app's impact on digital culture continues to grow. Like now we're seeing journalists, dermatologists, psychologists, economists, and more creating content on the app. So it's been really fun to see them fuse dancing and lip syncing with things like history, economics, health, and news. Here are a couple of examples. I don't want to lose now. I'm looking right at the other half of me. The thing Now, nearly 10 years ago, I created what I called the 5 R's of viral videos, which were the ways that people interacted with content in order for something to spread at scale or to go viral. Now, the 5 R's are reposting, remixing, reacting, reenacting, and reinventing. Now, with the exception of reposting, which we can do across every single social network, the rest of these behaviors required some type of technical or editing knowledge in order for you to be able to participate. Like, you needed to know how to extract a specific clip, edit it, alter it, re-upload it onto YouTube, and then share it again. And to understand why TikTok really shines, you have to see how the app is built with features that are aimed at facilitating the user's interactivity with these 5 R's. So letting them do all of these things without ever having to leave the platform, which makes it very easy for them to make content that can then go viral. This app was designed with an interactive, creative collaboration in mind, and all of the features specifically support this goal. And it all starts with this magical little button, this little spinning record. That's really important because one, it lets you use anyone's audio track to remix and interact with content. And two, it lets you see how other people have used the same sound, making it really easy for you to collaborate and participate in trends. This visibility also helps to build micro communities within the app itself. And in return for this ease, all of these great features, TikTok gets a user base that generate millions of pieces of content every day. Now, one last thing, TikTok is an ecosystem. So if you're only seeing one or two clips on the app and that's what you're judging the whole app on, you're really missing the brilliance of this collaborative digital infrastructure. So when people talk about TikTok users getting tens of millions of followers, you can start to understand why this is happening because the app was specifically designed to make it as easy as possible to create and to share with no fancy equipment or technical skills. So let's take a look at the five R's, and I'm going to use a really bizarre example, okay? It's just stay with me on this. It's the saga of Jackie Weaver and the Parish Zoom meeting. I'm not going to get into all the details because it's so weird, but basically there was this clip of a parish council meeting in the UK that was posted online, and it showed this dramatic face-off between two members. And one of them, Jackie Weaver, upon having her authority challenged, kicked out one of the other members from the Zoom call, which created a whole ton of drama. So here's the original clip.
You have no authority here, Jackie Weaver. No authority at all.
She's just kicked him out. She's kicked him out. Don't. She's kicked him out. Don't.
This is a meeting called by two councillors.
Illegally.
They now elect a chairman.
No, they can't, because the vice chair's here. I take charge. Read the standing orders. Read them and understand them.
Now, reposting is obviously the easiest and most common activity linked to virality because it's the one that has the lowest barrier of entry, because it's very easy to share someone else's content on your channel or to give a repost or whatever. Now, TikTok doesn't actually let you repost someone else's content to your own account because remember, they want you to use the content to make your own posts and your own riffs. But they do allow you to export almost any video on the platform to other social media sites. And unlike other companies that are obsessed with keeping you within their walled garden, they understand that we live in an interconnected content ecosystem and that traction outside of the platform will drive traffic back to the creator's page on TikTok. That's why when you export something, it always includes the account name of the creator and it's watermarked, which means you can tell that the content was made to be shared and exported and reposted all over the web. So no more trying to figure out how to download the content or trying to figure out who the original poster was. TikTok fixes all of that right away. With just a push of a button, I can save this content to my phone and I can share it with my WhatsApp groups, on my Instagram page, in my email, or more. So as you can see here, this drama has already been shared a fair amount of times. Now, the second R is remixing. And you can remix content easily because TikTok gives you access to several app filters and camera effects, letting you interpret both the audio and video aspects of the content. So remember, you don't need a lot of technical skills to participate, and everything you do need is found right inside the app. Now, remixing is a central tenet of meme culture in general, and TikTok's text features allows you to remix the content either through changing or editing the clips or reframing the actual content with text. So here, I'll show you examples where people are taking the original clip and they're turning it into a song, or they're using it with some other context.
This is a meeting called by two councillors.
Illegally.
This meeting has not been called according to the law.
Illegal to the law.
Will you please let the chairman speak?
She's not the proper officer.
Who is this woman?
Jackie Weaver. You have no authority here, Jackie Weaver.
No authority at all.
The chairman of the council is the chairman of the council. No authority here, Jackie Weaver.
Illegal.
The third R is reacting. So TikTok's musically roots means it was originally built for duets, right? But in this case, people use this feature to just create this like split screen where they can respond or show you how they are responding or reacting to the content in real time. So again, think about how easily the app enables this, right? You click a button and it instantly splits the screen in two, letting you upload your reaction without having to worry about any of the other technical stuff. Now, this one's pretty self-explanatory. Here's a really quick example.
This is a meeting called by two councillors.
Illegally.
They now elect a chairman.
No, they can't because the vice chair's here. I take charge.
The fourth R is reenacting. So reenacting is really fun. You basically just take the original clip and you lip sync to it and you just reenact it. You basically sync it in various different contexts. Here's a couple of examples.
You have no authority here, Jackie Weaver. No authority at all.
She's just kicked him out.
She's
kicked him out. Don't. She's kicked him out. Don't.
This is a meeting called by two counselors.
The fifth R is reinventing, and this is where people get creative. It's where they take the content and they expand it beyond the original clip. So in this case, on the original Zoom, there was someone that didn't have their camera turned on, and all we could see was this black Zoom square that said Jules's iPad. So obviously people started imagining what was happening behind the screen.
You have no authority here, Jackie Weaver. No authority at all.
She's just kicked him out. She's kicked him out. Don't. She's kicked him out. Don't.
This is a meeting called by two counselors.
So as you can see, these virtual activities have been around since the early days of social media, but TikTok is one of the first platforms to have all of these features embedded into the native app itself. This facilitates activities that result in the mass creation and sharing of content that leads to increased virality. Now, I think TikTok has actually added a new R, and that's randomness. Now, let me explain. Everything on TikTok happens from the For You page, the FYP. This is where you spend most of your time scrolling through this endless feed of content. But here's the twist. Unlike other apps, TikTok not only shows you the people whose accounts you follow, but they show you content that's doing well on the app that you might like from accounts you don't follow, giving you the chance to watch and share and interact with viral content from smaller or unknown accounts. This means that in today's fame-obsessed social media world, you don't need to have a large following to get TikTok famous. Now, this bypasses a really important traditional barrier that many people have on other platforms, which is this need to build a large audience. On TikTok, you can get hundreds of thousands of views depending on the benevolence of the algorithm. However, what you can do with that fleeting fame is still pretty limited, at least at this point in time. So while TikTok does have verified accounts and it does promote popular accounts, they also will promote unknown content, which creates this very competitive environment to get seen because everyone on TikTok has a chance to go viral. Everyone can make it big. So you'll see people posting stuff and then saying things like, don't let this flop, or please don't let this flop, meaning don't let it not get a lot of views, please let it go viral. And I've noticed that there are some smaller accounts or accounts with like small to medium followings that have one or two posts that have done really, really well, and then the rest of the posts only have a couple hundred views. Now, there's a lot of debate as to what the algorithm will actually promote, some people saying that it does favor pretty girls doing dances. And while I think that was true because of the early stage of users, I've now been on this app for months and I don't see that type of content anymore, so I think they're really fine-tuned the algorithm to show you stuff that matches your interests. There's also contention that despite the algorithm, the content that does well happens to be the ones that include attractive people dancing instead of smaller creators that do more involved posts like makeup tutorials or fashion or actually singing versus lip syncing. And that's also an ongoing debate about who gets to be famous and what the app favors. It's easy to write off this app, but honestly, there's such a great community of people that are creating wonderful content. They're being candid and surprising and vulnerable and informative. And we're seeing the impacts of Snapchat and Instagram stories in this new micro format where jokes, dances, and everything are being compressed into 15 to 60 seconds. Obviously, there is so much more to talk about: revenue models, algorithms, geopolitical impact, monetization, the impacts on attention span, the impacts of fame, the psychological risks of flopping. So the conversation is just getting started, so please check back for the next installment in this ongoing series. Thank you so much for watching. United we stand, and I'll see you next time.
The standing orders, read them and understand them. We are the rebels of the parish council. We are the rebels.